Although noting their wives' attraction to Krishna, did not become envious. The demigods are actually very refined in cultural intelligence, and therefore, when flying in their airplanes, they regularly take their wives along to see Krishna. The gopis thought, our husbands, on the other hand, are envious. Therefore, even the inferior deer are better off than we. And the demigoddesses are also very fortunate. Whereas we poor human beings in an intermediate position are most unfortunate. Dayana smamu dagatayo piharinyaetam yananda nandanam upata vichitra vesham akarnya venu ranitam saha krishna saraham pujanda durvirachitam pranayavalokahim. Blessed are all these foolish deer, because they have approached Maharajananda Swami, who is gorgeously dressed and is playing on his back. Indeed, both the doe and the box worshipping the Lord with looks of love and affection. Krishnam niriksha vanitot svarupashilam shrutvacha tatkvanita venu vivikta gitam devyo vimana gatayak smaranuna saram vrashyat prasuna kovaramu mukul vinirbyaham. Krishna's beauty and character create a festival for all women. Indeed, when the demigods' wives flying in airplanes with their husbands catch sight of him and hear his resonant flute song, their hearts are shaken by Cupid, and they become so bewildered that the flowers fall out of their hair and their belts loosen. So now, after 1 month break, we are back to our 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And I would like a little bit to remind us what is actually going on, because after 1 month reading second canto, we may forget a little bit how story is developing. So, we were listening about Krishna's pastime from his birth, childhood, then how he was herding the cows, then he all of a sudden started to herd cows. And then descriptions of autumn in Vrindavan, and now we just started the chapter which is called Gopis. The Gopis glorified Krishna's flute. In this point, Gopis still didn't start to have personal contact with Krishna, so they are just listening about him. They are listening from the cowherd boys, which are their brothers and friends, village friends. They are listening from them what is actually happening with Krishna during the day when he is taking care of the cows. And they are also every day, every evening, they are waiting for Krishna to come back from the forest, and they are looking at him, and just they are now in a phase that they are falling in love with Krishna. And we can see now they are observing very, very nicely what is going on. And they notice that Krishna's flute, a small bamboo flute which Krishna is having and playing, that it has very big influence. Their hearts starting to melt when they hear this flute. And they are seeing that this flute also has influence on other living entities. They just noticed in yesterday's verse how peacocks are dancing very nicely by listening to these flutes. And also on the top of the hills there is so many other living entities which are observing all this performance. Krishna is playing flute and peacocks are dancing. So some of these creatures which are observing all this performance of Krishna playing flutes are deers. In this today's verse we are listening how gopis are now glorifying deers. They are in one way they could associate with the deers, because we know that gopis they look from point of view of someone who is not very educated, they look that they are just simple cowherd girls. But we can see in many points in Krishna books that they know very well all the shastras, they know what happened in the history, which relationship Krishna had with others in the previous lifetimes. Shri Radha Lalmanishwara ki, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra ki, Shri Gonitaya ki, Giri Govardhana ki. So we can see in many instances they are quoting what happened in previous yugas, what happened in Krishna's previous incarnations. So in the same way, they know that Dears went so much suffering previously. It started in the beginning of creation when Lord Brahma became attracted with his daughter. So she wanted to hide, she wanted to run away, so she transformed herself in a deer. But then Lord Brahma also took form of the stag, so deers were a little bit condemned from this incident. Then second incident happened in the Treta Yuga, when Lord Ramachandra and Sita, they were playing in the forest, and Marichi, one magician, Marichi, was convinced by Ravana that he should go and take a form of the golden deer to attract the mind of Sita. And with all this incident started all very sad story of Ravana kidnapping Sita. So this was the second instance where deers were a little bit in uncomfortable position. Then gopis are remembering also third instance where it was King Bharat, Maharaj Bharat. He was king of all world, and then he took sannyas, he went in the forest. But by taking care of his pet deer, he lost his transcendental position. He fell down from his transcendental position. And because of all this happened, deers became very shy. They were hiding deeply inside the forest. They were running away of everybody. They didn't want to be seen. But then when it happened that Krishna was performing his pastimes and they came close, and then Krishna, they were glancing at Krishna and Krishna touched them. By this touch, they managed to release their guilt. And also by gopis glorifying deers, then they managed to release shame. So then they became happy again. And especially when Lord Chaitanya was performing his pastimes, that he also came in Vrindavan, and deers were attracted with his singing and dancing. They came close, and they were licking his body, and they were participating in this Harinam Sankirtan. They were dancing and singing together with the lions. The gopis are glorifying all these deers. They were looking at them and they were saying, look at these deers. They just want to look at the Krishna. Their only desire is that Krishna glance at them. And way how they are worshipping Krishna with their glances. They don't have anything else to offer. For example, peacocks are offering their feathers, but deers don't have anything to offer. They are just offering their glances. And then another gopi said, yeah, it looks that this kind of worshipping they learn from us, gopis, because we are also worshipping Krishna just by our glances, just by looking at them. In this way, and they also knew that all these deers are actually big sages who took birth as deers in Krishna's presence in Vrindavan. And they have all knowledge, all transcendental knowledge, but this knowledge appeared to become covered in Krishna's presence. And we can see gopis, they are also, it's described that all these gopis in a Krishna Lila, there are actually two categories of gopis. One of them, one category is Nitya Sidas, which are eternally liberated souls. Another category is Sadhana Sidas. So these are souls which became perfect by performing some process. They became perfect, and then in the end they took birth as associate of the eternally liberated gopis to become even more perfect. They became students of this eternally liberated gopis, and they are learning how to actually interact with Krishna properly. This is this final touch on their perfection. And they are also learning about Goloka, learning about relationships in between all inhabitants of Vrindavan. Because if they just came directly from the material universe straight into Goloka Vrindavan, they would not know when someone asked them, whose sister is this gopi, whose mother is that? They would not know these details. So this is one of the things which they are supposed to learn when they come. And out of this, out of this second group of the gopis, there are also six categories who came there. It is also described that at the time when Lord Chaitanya was here, then there was many people who wanted to have some association with him, and they all became gopis. So one group of them was when Lord Krishna went in Mithila. In Mithila, then he got married with Sita, and during the wedding, and when he was there were so many other ladies who were attracted with Lord Ramachandra. They also wanted him to have as their husband, because he was so attractive, especially beautiful, full of all opulences, and they were naturally attracted to him. But he couldn't accept them because he took vow of only one wife, and he promised them the next time when he comes, he will accept them. Then on their way from Mithila to Ayodhya, they stop in Koshala, where Lord Ram was fighting with Parashuram. And also there were a group of ladies there who were also attracted to him. So he promised to them also same thing, next time when I come, I will accept you. Then in his own birthplace, Ayodhya, there were also one group of ladies with same desires, he promised to them as well. Then when he went in a forest with Sita, they were living in a forest, and there were so many sages there who were highly elevated souls, and they were also very much attracted to the Lord. They also approached to the Lord. They didn't want to openly express their desire, but Krishna knew they wanted to offer him service as a Sita. And Lord told them, you know, you can't be as a Sita, because Sita is one, but in my next time when I come, I will accept all of you. Then there is also one group. After all this story finished with Ravana and Sita was taken back, and they lived nicely in Ayodhya. But after some time, Krishna ended up in a forest again for some reason, and Ramachandra remained as a king in the kingdom. But as a king, he's supposed to do so many yagyas, so many sacrifices, and he was doing this. But also it is prescribed that the king has to do this together with his wife. Sita was in the forest, he took vow of only one wife, so what to do? What they were doing in these cases, they were making a deity of Sita. And so for the sacrifice, that was one Sita's deity, which was participating in sacrificing. And then after this, she would put in one place. And then after some time, it was one room, one palace full of all those Sitas, deities of Sita. And then they approached to Lord Ram. They wanted to get married with him. They wanted to have a little bit more exchange of him. But he didn't want, and he also promised them, next time when I come, then I will accept all of you. So from all these six groups, all of them took birth in Vrindavan as a gopis, and they were all participating in all these pastimes. In this case, we can see they are glorifying flute, they are glorifying Krishna's, how Krishna is playing this flute, and the effects which this flute has on inhabitants of Vrindavan. And also, as Prabhupada mentioned here, it has also a universal effect. Let me see how he said properly. It says, transcendental sound of the flute of Krishna extend to all corners of the universe. So we can see that is this flute attracted the deers and also attracted the wives of demigods. We can see demigods are coming with their aeroplanes, with their wives sitting on their lap, and they are also attracted to Krishna. There is one reason, because this flute which is playing, there is one special day when Krishna is playing one special raga, which is very, very rare raga, which is called Manogya. This means that raga knows the mind of everyone who are listening. So then this flute adjusts it sounds and vibration exactly how it's suitable for one who is listening. So in that way, also the wives of demigods that are also so attracted. They are watching Krishna, how he's nicely dressed, nicely decorated. Because this is a big part of Krishna's pastimes, all this dressing and decorating Krishna. In Vrindavan, they are making so many festivals. And Krishna is dressed very nicely every day. He's nicely dressed and decorated. But especially for the festivals, they decorate him even more. And then all women are so happy to come for these celebrations and look at Krishna in these celebration uniforms. And then they enjoy even more. So there are so many of these festivals organized in Vrindavan. One of those festivals is, for example, Holi. It's a very well-known festival which is happening on Gaur Purnima day when they are going around and throwing colors. We can see in Vrindavan, the inhabitants of Vrindavan, they have very colorful dress. It's not like in London. In London, most of the time we see outside people are very black. But in Vrindavan, we can see people having so many different colors clothes. But on Holi, this is not enough that they already have colorful clothes, but they are going around with colors and drawing on each other, so they have multicolored clothes and they have fun in this way. There is also one other pastimes when Krishna is collecting tax on a bottom of Govardhan Hill. And as a tax collector, he also has special uniform. And then when the gopis are coming from the Radha Kund, they are carrying ghee, then Krishna said, okay, we need ghee for sacrifices, so you should give us some ghee. And even from the distance, Radha is telling to Lalita, oh, I saw Krishna in so many different clothes already, but this one, this particular one is so special, I never saw that one. So they are really enjoying in Krishna's different dress. And then, of course, they have long discussion there on the bottom of the hill, and then gopis proceed further on. There is also one pastime where is Krishna's dress quite prominent. And this pastime, Rupa and Raghunath Goswami, they ask Jiva Goswami to describe it. And it's called this pastime Madhava Mahotsava. So in this pastime, Krishna wanted to Radharani to become queen of Vrindavan. He was already queen of his heart, of everything what he has, but he wants to officially make it the queen of his home, because Vrindavan is actually his home. So he met with Vrinda, and he told to Vrinda, ask her to make arrangement about that. Vrinda accepted immediately, and she, in the form of a voice from the sky, revealed herself to Purnamasi and explained to her how it would be so nice to install Radharani as the queen of Vrindavan and prepare Abhishek and all this celebration, whatever is needed. And at the same time, she also came to Radharani as a voice from the sky and convinced Radharani that she should accept this. She should accept this worshipping of residents of Vrindavan, and she should become queen and their protector. And this will be for the benefit of all. So they announced this all around Vrindavan. Everybody knew what will happen. Krishna became happy. And this day came. They were bathing Radharani. They took all waters from Manasi Ganga, Yamuna, from Sarasvati. And then they were using also yogurt, milk, ghee for bathing Radharani. And it was looking like a flow of nectar is going through the golden mountain. And they were performing Abhishek to Radharani. And after all this Abhishek was done, they dressed her nicely, decorated her nicely, put her royal divas, and she became queen. That was very nice. And all gopis, of course, her friend, she gave to all her friends high position in the kingdom. They all became ministers and whatever they wanted. And Lalita became chief minister, prime minister, Lalita. But Krishna didn't get any service. And then he approached to Lalita, to the prime minister, and he said, oh, you know, I would also like some service. And then Lalita said, well, I'm not quite sure that there is something what would be really suitable for you. Yes, yes, I know one service I would like to be chief constable, and I would like to just go around and announce the glory of the of the Radharani and make sure that there is nothing wrong going there, that everybody really accepts her. And then Lalita said, okay, you can write application letter and then we will see. So Krishna wrote very nice application letter and he was accepted in this service. And he got uniform suitable to be chief constable. And he was going around and he was proclaiming that Radharani is queen and glorifying her. And after some time he came back and he said, okay, I did my service nicely. He gave report what happened. Everybody are accepting you as only queen and master, and everybody are happy with your role. And that was very nice. And Krishna said, but there is one problem. Krishna, in the meantime, he hide his flute, this flute, what is we are talking about, this small bamboo flute. He hide it in Lalita's bed. So he said, some theft here in your kingdom. Someone has stolen my flute. And then Lalita said, okay, that's great. You see, this flute was causing so many troubles. Now finally we will be able to sleep peacefully during the night. There is not going to be this flute which will take us away during the night, in the middle of the night. But Radharani said, hey, wait a minute. If everybody knows that in our kingdom theft is accepted, this is not going to be good. We have to do something about this. But Lalita said, you see, how he is going to protect us if he is not able to protect even his own property? Which kind of constable is this? He should resign immediately. And Krishna said, he addressed Radharani, well, if you allow me, I would like to tell you something. You know, I'm just low class servant, but what if some, you know, this my flute, what if it is stolen from some high minister, from some high position servant? How I can claim something against it? What can I do about that? And then Lalita said, okay, everybody please open your veils, we will see that this is actually not true. So each gopis, all these ministers, they came and opened their veils one by one, food didn't come. But in the end, when Lalita, last one, opened her veil, that food was there. And then Krishna said, you see which kind of prime minister is this? I think that this prime minister should resign. And then Lalita get upset, they were fighting a little bit, and then she said in the end, okay, I'm sure you did it, you made all this, you hide flute there, it's your mischievous act. No, it's not true, Krishna said. Okay, if it's not true, then you go to our queen, then you give all to her lotus feet that you didn't do this. And then Krishna was approaching to Radharani's lotus feet, and then he started to shake from ecstasy. And then Radharani saw him in this humble position and how he's in ecstasy, but just by approaching to her lotus feet, then he said, okay, now enough is enough, so please come and sit here beside me and you become king of Vrindavan. And then he became king and Vrinda came and he presented special uniform, different uniform for king, for Krishna as a queen. So in this way we can see how they're also, how this dress and decorating also has such a big influence in Vrindavan. And ladies are naturally attracted with nice dresses and nice ornaments which Krishna has. And then gopis are noticing, you see, not only this, even the wives of demigods, they are also attracted with all this. And they are also expressing their attractions. They are not just uneducated like deers. They have quite high knowledge, but still they get completely lost when they see Krishna, when they see how beautiful he is and when they hear the song from his flute. But they are so fortunate, both of them, even deers and demigoddesses as well, because their husbands are not complaining about this. Their husbands are worshipping Krishna together with them. Deers came together with the husbands, and demigods came, it says here, demigods came with their wives in their lap. So demigods, because of their knowledge, they didn't really lose control of their body. They were much more reserved, But their wives, they became completely overwhelmed. We can see this something similar happened also in Vrindavan, when Krishna and Balaram, they send the boys to approach the wives to the Brahmanas who were making sacrifices and ask them for food. They didn't want to give them, they were just concentrating on what they were doing. And they were considering those boys just to be distraction on their doing the yagya. But their wives, they were happy immediately, they jumped, they gave food to the Krishna Balaram. So we can see also in Devadats and their wives are also a little bit more, they are easier accepting this attraction to the Krishna. But their demigods are not complaining about this, they are not jealous as husbands of the gopis. Husbands of the gopis are all the time jealous if gopis are talking about Krishna, if they are looking at Krishna. They are even saying they become jealous even when they hear the name of the Krishna or when they feel the smell of his body. And we can see many times there is so many instances of Radharani and Abhimanyu, how Radharani is trying to run away to meet with Krishna, and all these stories with Jatila and Kutila. All this is going on and a little bit making pastimes even more relishable. And then also one gopi was asking, how do we know that these wives of demigods, they are there with their husbands? Maybe they are just by themselves, like we are coming along. And then another gopi answered, we know because, you know, they came in these aeroplanes. How wives of demigods could be able to drive such a complicated machine? So we can see they have so much knowledge these gopis are having about universe and universal affairs and whatever is going on. Even though they appear to be simple village girls, they are actually highly educated and very knowledgeable. And there is also, so they were, in this way they are glorifying deers which are lower creatures and demigoddesses which are higher beings. And said, why we are so unfortunate? You see, even lower than us and higher than us are so fortunate in their service to Krishna. Only we are so unfortunate. So they are lamenting about themselves, about their bad fortune. And in this way they are spending their days in a Vrindavan, and they are in this way trying to become connected with Krishna. So this was a little bit about these two verses. All this chapter that we are reading now, this chapter 21, the gopis glorify Krishna's flute, is known as the Venu Gita. Just this is the exact translation, glorifying of Krishna's flute. And there is His Holiness Shivaram Swami, he wrote a book, Venu Gita, which is based on this chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam. And this is very nice books. This actually I'm just now giving reference. All this what I said, I read in these books. There is one chapter which was dedicated to these two verses which we have today. So we have this book on our shop on the second floor. So if someone is interested to know a little bit more, a little bit deeper about all these pastimes, what we are reading here on Srimad Bhagavatam, it's available there. Okay, I would like to stop here. There is 5 more minutes left over. If someone has some question or comment.
Just one comment. It's very interesting that the demigoddesses were attracted to Krishna. And that brought to mind this analogy used by Srila Prabhupada, that a baby, you know, it's crying and you pass it from one lady to another, and it's not satisfied. Only when the baby reaches Krishna is the baby satisfied. And I was thinking that the demigoddesses that have wonderful husbands and surrounded by so much openness, but still there must be some dissatisfaction there when they see Krishna, they immediately attract Krishna.
Yes. So I'll just repeat for our customers on YouTube and also on the webcam, Prabhupada was saying that Prabhupada often gives comment that when a child is crying, and it may go from one hands from one person to another, and it still keep crying and it's not satisfied until it reaches the mother, and then stops crying. And then in the same way that we can see all these demigods and demigoddesses, they have so much opulence, they have everything, nice husband, whatever they can think about, but still they are attracted to Krishna. It looks like something is missing, that Krishna is not there. Yes, this is true. And it's an example even of Lakshmi. Even Lakshmi is attracted to Krishna. She also wanted to come into Krishna's pastimes. She was performing severe austerities to come into Krishna's pastimes. But because she couldn't give all her opulences, she couldn't come in. So this is maybe point even in the wives of demigods and all these demigods. They are also devotees of the Krishna, they are attracted to Krishna, they are approaching to Krishna whenever they need. But they are kind of materialistic kind of devotees. They are attached to their opulences and they don't want to give this away. But we can see gopis, they are attached only to the Krishna. Whatever else it is, that it doesn't really has any value for them. And also they are on such a high level of devotion, then also it may be asked, when their gopis see such a high devotion in the deers and in the demigoddesses, is it really true or they are just perceiving it like this? And it's answered that, you know, when someone is in a really pure devotee, he sees everybody else as a pure devotee. So gopis, they were really pure devotees and completely dedicated to the Krishna, so automatically they were thinking that everybody else is. Okay, so we will finish now. Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Srila Prabhupada ki.